Hey, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Well, we're going to jump right into some prayer here. And so if you bow your heads for a second, I'm going to go ahead and start praying before I get started. Father in heaven, thank you, God, so much for an opportunity to look at your word. Father, I know I do not deserve to be here. I do not deserve to speak your word. But I do pray that you give me wisdom to encourage the church.
Amen. Come on.
That we may keep in step with the Holy Spirit.
Yes,
that we may empty ourselves, Father, and fill ourselves with you. That there may be less of us and more of you in this world. That we may humble ourselves before you and seek you. Father, we have an opportunity today to learn from you and to encourage each other. And I pray through your Spirit you help us make the most of this. And I pray all of this in your Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, well, we got quite a bit going on as a family and as a church right now. One thing I would like to say is that Frank and Michelle are out of town right now. That's why you see me here standing. But we are also continuing on in our series on the Holy Spirit. But I had a special evening last night that we celebrated that actually could be celebrated today. It's my 12-year anniversary for being married to my lovely wife there. Truly a jewel, you know. She gets an extra crown and extra jewel in her crown for being married to me for 12 years. But I would not be where I am today in any facet without her. So I really appreciate just all the love she has poured out to me over the years. And so if you would just encourage her a little bit afterwards, I'm just definitely grateful to be married to her. But as many of you know, we have a rivalry within our house because she went to the University of Michigan Law School. And I went to Ohio State for 2 years. So we were actually married on the day of the game 12 years ago.
Wow.
You know, previous to the college football series where they moved the game back a week, the day we got married, Ohio State and Michigan were playing. And I was watching the game before I went out to get married. And it was one of the first times Ohio State had won in a long time. And they have kept on winning since then. Not all the time. But that's our kind of rivalry within our house. It kind of even goes back to when we were dating, that one of our first dates was watching the game the previous year. And so it has a lot of history within our family. You know, rivalries are fun, and I know that this rivalry up north means nothing to the rivalry down south, which is happening next weekend.
Yeah.
Right? Because it pales in comparison to the Auburn and Alabama rivalry.
Yeah.
But what everybody understands about a rivalry is that it's intense. It is intense, and it is a knockdown, drag-out kind of competition. No holds barred kind of competition.
Right.
But what's interesting about rivalries is, deep down, I don't want it to be a blowout game. Deep down, I want it to be a good game.
Yeah.
Unless I'm the one in the game. Because when you're the one in the game, and it's a back-and-forth kind of contest, that means you've made some mistakes. And that means that the other person has made some good plays.
Yeah.
And those are kind of hard to deal with, the disappointment of. And you say, well, Sean, how does all this fit in the learning about the Holy Spirit? And I'm going to get there in just a second. But what's interesting is that we began a series on the Holy Spirit. And the first one we did had to do with understanding that the secret things belong to God. Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 29. So what does that mean? That means that there's some things that God didn't feel the need to explain to us. And that's okay.
Right.
And we have to be okay with that, even in the information age. Right?
Right.
But the other part of that verse is that the things that he has revealed belong to us. And those things are the things that we have to take very seriously. Because if he said we should do it, then we should do it.
Right.
And so then on our second lesson, And Frank was able to echo each one of those lessons with some more teaching on the Holy Spirit. Had to deal with how we know if we have the Holy Spirit or not.
Right.
And that is not something that based on an emotional or miraculous experience, but is as simple as applying our lives back to the Bible and seeing whether we have obeyed what he has said. Now, those lessons are online, and you can revisit those if you feel like after I'm done speaking today, you didn't quite have a great grasp of what I was getting at. But what we're moving to today is the assumption that after you have tested yourself to understand whether you have the Holy Spirit or not, well, now the assumption is if you have that Holy Spirit within you, if you have Christ inside you, then how in the world do you keep in step with that Spirit? How in the world do you tap into that power inside you so that your life can demonstrate that kind of glory?
Come on.
So that's what we're going to get into today. As you look up and you see all the different pictures I have up there and how I'm keeping in step, you know, what comes to mind, there's just so many things that come to my mind when I think about keeping in step. And I found a variety of pictures up there to help kind of explain my thought process. You see in the far corner up there, we got a larger duck, a mama duck, and a baby duck, right? Trying to keep up together. You see on the other side, you see some dancing happening. And then at the very bottom, you see a very militaristic cadence. Everybody keeping in step together. Well, what I want you to do is turn over to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, we're going to start reading in verse 26. And if you can go to the next slide, we're going to try and chip away at understanding what this means to keep in step. If I have the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ inside me, what does it mean to keep in step with it? What does that mean practically so that when I leave church today, I can feel like I have a game plan for achieving that success? So we'll get over here into Colossians, and this is a bit of a review. We'll start in verse 26. It says, "The mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the saints. To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We proclaim him, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone perfect in Christ. To this end I labor, struggling with all his energy, which so powerfully works in me." Now you may have a different version slightly in your Bible, depending on the version that you read. Some say, "I strenuously contend with all the energy that Christ so powerfully works within me." Well, what you'll notice here up here on the PowerPoint is I got some different pictures lined up again. These are ancient athletic games and even an ancient battle. So I thought I need to understand those two words a lot better, strenuously and contend. Because Paul's here talking about all this energy of Christ working inside me. Well, what in the world does that mean to contend with it, to strenuously contend with it? Wow. So if you go to the next slide here, and I'm trying to get some understanding here about what this means to have Christ inside of me. Well, this word strenuously is the Greek word meaning kopaio, exhausting labor, to labor until worn out, depleted, bodily or mentally, labor alike. So what this means is that for Paul, knowing he had Christ inside him, it wasn't this easy transition to work within the Spirit of Christ. It meant that it took all of his energy, bodily and mentally, to keep up with Christ. It took everything he had. Hey, anybody ever felt exhausted before?
Yeah.
Right? Raise your hand, felt exhausted before, right? Sometimes my wife works so hard throughout the day, all the way, not just at work, right? Because her day starts way before work. It starts when she gets up and she's trying to serve us. Right? Sometimes my wife can get so tired, it looks like she's going to fall asleep while she's walking. Eyes just dropping and drooping. So the minute that she sits down, guess what? She's out. You want to know why Jesus could fall asleep in a boat during a storm? Because he was exhausted from serving, right? And any of you that have undertaken the great task of serving others, you understand what that feels like. It is exhausting. But it is also exactly what Paul is talking about right here. That it takes all of what we have. Then that next word in there, contend, is another Greek word, agnosimai. And what that means is a conflict or struggle. It means to agonize, properly to struggle like engaged in an intense athletic contest or warfare. Not exactly what I thought I was going to find out when I was trying to figure out how to get the most out of Christ inside me. To start talking about warfare or an athletic contest. But if you think about it, you understand this more than maybe what you give yourself credit for. Because you've experienced this war within to do the right thing. And you've experienced it countless times. But this battle within to make Christ known. Because see, I don't know how it is for you, but for me, I always want to make it seem as if the battle is on the outside. That if somebody else wouldn't have hurt me the way they did, that if somebody else wouldn't have looked at me or said what they did, that if somebody would do better at what they were supposed to be doing, then that is where my battle is at. But the real battle is within me. What I'm really contending with, or should contend with, is that battle on the inside. Now, I don't know anything about warfare because I've never fought in a war. But I do know something about athletic contests. Because when I was younger, I played soccer, and I played baseball, and I played basketball. As I got older, I played football more and more, and I wrestled. And the sports I played involved more and more competition. And what I learned from those sports is you just didn't compete on game day. If you wanted to be good at something, you better be willing to compete every time you played the sport. You better prepare ahead. So even in practice, guess what? There's competition. And when they blow that whistle during competition, if you're not ready for your opponent, is your opponent going to stop after the whistle's blown and ask you how you feel about competing? Not at all. They are just going to compete. So now we got to start thinking to ourselves, Paul describes Christ inside him as a mentally and physically exhausting contest to deal with all the energy that Christ has inside him. So now we got to start looking at, well, who is the opponent? Turn over to Galatians chapter 5. If you go to the next slide, please. Galatians chapter 5. So over here in Galatians chapter 5, we understand that we have a competition here. We understand that it's intense and it takes all that we have. But then we got to start seeing who we are competing against. Galatians chapter 5, starting in verse 16, says, "So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict." That word conflict in its Greek form means directly opposed. They have nothing in common with one another. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. So let's take a moment and try to digest this before we move on, that we have this great conflict within us if we have the Holy Spirit. We have this great battle within us if we have the Holy Spirit. And we don't have this battle every other day. We don't have this battle once a week. We have this battle every moment of every day. And that is why it is so exhausting for me. And that is why I'm always looking for a reason to check out or have a break or disengage. Because this battle is so intense and so consistent that it can wear me down to the bone. So what are we to make of this in trying to understand and how to keep in step with the Spirit? We know there's a battle in us. We know Christ is inside us. We know Christ wants to be shown to the world. But before we can show Christ to the world, we have to handle the greatest opponent that we will ever face, which is looking at us in the mirror Every single day. So let's take a look at this in Galatians chapter 5, starting in verse 21. Actually, we'll start at verse 19. Verse 19, it says, the acts of the sinful nature are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying each other. Now that is a mouthful. You know, and I think probably the most humbling part about that for me is the fact that, you know, when it's going over the list of sins, the acts of the sinful nature, kind of paints the picture of all those things. It goes, and the like. So anything else you can think of that's not on the list, put that on there too. But I didn't always give credit, like I have this unique way of shielding myself from the Bible. So I can quickly point to what I'm not doing. So what do I mean by that? Well, if we go back to verse 19, and it says that the acts of the sinful nature are obvious, and they say sexual immorality. And I'm like, well, I'm married, and I'm faithful in my marriage, so I'm not doing it, right? And you can start associating and taking yourself away from the scriptures instead of really zeroing in on the ones that really do apply and are still troubling you right now. Right? Because you can be going to church every weekend and not be living by the Spirit of God. So church attendance is not what we're talking about right here. We're talking about that relationship with God that is so close that you keep in step with His Spirit each day. So here are some things that I would like to encourage you in ways God has humbled me over the years. And some of the things that God has really humbled me about are some of those words that I don't give as much attention to. I was really zeroed in as a young guy on lust and sexual immorality, so repenting of those things were big deals in my life. But as I've gotten older, it's not like those things are easy, but other areas have become more pronounced and more challenging at times. So words like dissensions and factions and selfish ambition, those words become much more pronounced as a challenge in my heart because I tend to think more highly of my own opinion than I need to. So I want you to think as I explain some of these words and I read some definitions to you, if they convict you, then I want you to say amen. Because they convict me every time I read them. In no particular order, some of the Greek words that we use for strife, or factions, or divisions, are explained like this. To quarrel, a readiness to quarrel.
Amen.
To be contentious.
Amen.
For disputing. Seeking followers. Rivalry. Self-seeking. To stand apart from others, to separate people over something that is pointless. A self-chosen opinion in religion or philosophy. A self-chosen opinion. These are things that really convict me because what I fell into as a sin was a me-first Christianity. And that means that I came to church expecting other people to serve me. I came to church expecting other people to fix my problems. I came to church expecting other people to change and having a much higher expectation on other people changing than I did on myself. A me first Christianity, which is no Christianity at all. Because you won't find that anymore. That's not what Jesus taught about. But these are the things that Satan can tempt us with and that our sinful natures crave so deeply that we can easily latch onto, and all of a sudden we're not keeping in step with the Spirit anymore. We have replaced a relationship with God with a religion. With a religion that is heavy and hard, and not only heavy and hard on us, it's hard on other people because we demand them to change. While we don't lift a finger at changing ourselves. We call others to a higher level of surrender than what we will call ourselves to. And I live this out. I'm here speaking to you now here, but there was a time when Frank took me out of leadership because I had too worldly of a focus. I did it in my family, where I was really considering moving my family against the best interests of my family because I wanted to chase my job, my dream, my career. And I wrestled hard with it because it's what I wanted and how I wanted things to be. And it was a hard pill to swallow to live for others. So maybe you can relate with that. Maybe you can relate with how hard it is to consistently make decisions to let Christ outside of you, to win the battle within, to love other people, instead of having that me first mentality. Because you know, when it comes in, you know, what's amazing to me is my daughter can sing through the fruits of the Spirit. I can't. Love, peace, joy. There you go, baby. And you know, I don't have to go very long on that list because what always gets me is patience. Because the Greek word for that is long temper. The opposite of what? A short temper. Yeah, so having a short temper, they can put my picture in the dictionary. Being easily offended. That's me. Getting hurt and wounded easily. I can write a book on that. 12 years of marriage has taught me that that's not very valuable. But being long-tempered and being long-suffering with people, that builds a lot of love in a family. So my questions for you are this. If you have the Holy Spirit within you, how alert are you to the context, to the warfare that's happening inside of you every moment of every day? Because just because you're not giving that context or that battle attention doesn't mean it's not happening. How many of you know what it feels like to be ignored and rejected? Now, you're not hearing what I'm saying. I'm not saying like, I called you, you didn't call me back. I'm talking ignored and rejected. I'm talking wounded. To really be hurt by someone that you've reached out your arms wide to. Raise your hand if you've been ignored or rejected in life where you felt that kind of wound. Now what I want you to think about, how does God feel inside you? How does God feel inside you that He waited on you until you were converted? And then once He put His Spirit inside you, He's grieved by bitterness, rage, and anger. He's quenched because his idea is too radical for us. And he's ignored and rejected even though he's within sight. How does God feel to be rejected after all he has done for us? And if he would go to the cross for us, how deep of our convictions to stay in step with him? You know, these thoughts are so challenging to me. And they challenge me to my core because I just want to break. I just want it to stop for a minute. I want some time off. But the scripture that God has kept sending to me this week has been what he wants me to meditate on. So turn over to Galatians chapter 6. You can go to the next slide, please. We're going to pick up here in verse 7. I do encourage you to study verses 1 through 5 because they are very healthy as well, involved in keeping in step with the Spirit. All right? And that's a whole other sermon for a whole other time, but actually just some practical advice of how you, by following the Holy Spirit, can help other people who are caught in sin, and how you can share your burdens with each other, but at the end of the day, you have to carry your own load. So we should be sharing our lives with one another, but we shouldn't expect somebody else to carry our lives. Good distinction there. Because no matter how much I share with my wife what it's like to be chronically in pain, who still has to live within it? I do. And God still expects me to live in a way that expresses love. But as we pick up there in verse 7, it says, "Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Whoever sows to please their flesh, from their flesh will reap destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers." If I had a dollar for every time I felt like God sent me the scripture to not become weary in doing good, I might be able to retire right now. Because as I've said, the big thing is for me is I always want to break. And so God uses this analogy of reaping and sowing. And we don't have Josh here because Josh is a good farmer. His family's out, they're all sick, and he's sick too, he has a migraine, but he is a farming guy. I mean, each time it's season, he brings vegetables and fruits and all these things up that he has grown from the earth. Not that fake organic stuff from the store, right? Real stuff has been grown from the earth. And my one attempt at farming was a disaster, an absolute disaster. We tried to grow some strawberries in our backyard. Not only the birds, the squirrels came and took them too. And that's only the ones that grew. Right? Because the ones that grew needed some nurturing and some care that I wasn't always the best at giving. So we had this motley little garden that we were trying to get going, and eventually some things kind of grew, but whatever grown was eaten by nature. And we never got a taste of it, and then I quit. I quit farming. I said, I don't have the patience for this, I'll just go to the store. But you know, what's funny about this culturally is that I get upset if I have to go to the store twice in a day or twice in a weekend because I forget something, right? Because I don't grow it in my backyard, I gotta go to the store and buy it, right? So if I miss it on the store, I gotta go back to it. But culturally, where I get really disconnected from the Bible, that is, they didn't have a store to go to. So if they wanted something, they had to grow it. They had to take the time to put the seeds in the ground. They had to put all the hard work in a farming. You go to the next slide here. There's some hard work in farming. Yeah. You know, the picture on the right shows a man really working the land, the labor that's in there, right? The picture on the left, if you're a history person, what you understand is that in the 1930s, when our country went through the Great Depression, we had a lot of farmers in the middle of the United States who worked very hard at planting crops, waiting on rain, and then in the middle of it, there was a dust bowl storm. And those dust winds were as high as 30 to 60 to 90 feet in the air and would wipe out everybody's crops. So while they did for months all this work to plant and to grow all these crops, and then all of a sudden this big storm comes in that's not generated by a man, but is pushed by a sovereign God. It wipes out all their crops. And they can't go to Publix. They can't go to Walmart. They can't go somewhere and buy something to save the day. They have to go back and start farming again. And waiting again. And making it happen out of what they have. So why are we talking about all this? Because culturally, we've really separated ourselves away from the perseverance and the patience it takes to keep in step with the Holy Spirit. Because it isn't happening right now, it must not happen. Because God didn't move sooner, He must not be moving. Because God didn't give me my answer right now, He must not be willing to give it. And instead of long-suffering and being faithful, all those aspects that are fruits of the Spirit, we all quit on our hope and our faith in God. Not you, but the person next to you. Because I know you got it all together. But the person next to you is struggling with their faith in God. But what I find is the most challenging about this is understanding that for me to keep in step with the Holy Spirit, the greatest challenge I have is not growing weary and doing the good I know to do. Let me say that again. The greatest challenge I have in keeping in step with God's Holy Spirit inside me is not something abstract that I can't figure out. It's doing what I know I should be doing. I know what it takes for me to do well spiritually. I know the confession and the reading. I know the prayer it takes. But how willing am I to give it every day? You know, the next slide here, it shows a father and son. And they're farmers. And it says, Dad, what's a day off? I don't know, son. We're farmers. What does that mean indirectly? There are no days off. There are no days off in making the right decisions to keep in step with the Holy Spirit. Now, that doesn't mean that it's going to look the same in each family. What do I mean by that? Well, if you're single right now, your life's going to look a whole lot different than if you're married with five kids. Your availability is a lot different, for one. But understanding that for your circumstances in life, you keeping in step with the Holy Spirit is as simple as, are you winning the battle within to be a vessel of love to others? Galatians 5 says it the best, and I'll leave off with you there. But see, the Galatian church was really struggling with a lot of legalism. You know, and we've talked about a lot about the Corinthian church and how worldly it was, and he kept coming back to the Holy Spirit about it. You know, they were struggling with sexual morality, divisions in church, suing each other. And Paul just kept coming back to them one way or another. Do you understand that Christ is inside you? You're a temple of the Holy Spirit. You shouldn't be acting like this. Well, on the other end of the spectrum over here in the Galatian church, they were just getting so self-righteous with one another, provoking one another, thinking of themselves better than one another. And he had to bring them back to the Holy Spirit too. So whether you're acting worldly or self-righteous, God is calling us back to where? To look in the mirror and understand what's inside us. And in Galatians 5, he says it here. Galatians chapter 5, verse 6. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. So it doesn't matter how much you know, it matters whether you can communicate that in love. Brothers and sisters, I want us to think about these things and pray about these things. Because the greatest battle we face is not the people around us or our challenges at our jobs. But the greatest battle and contest that we face is our determination to not grow weary in doing what we know is right to do.
Amen.
To God be the glory.
Amen.